This is the level two module covering reclamation plans for borrow, waste, and staging areas for the North Carolina Department of Transportation Erosion and Sediment Control Certification Program. The instructor is Rich McLaughlin, professor in the Department of Crop and Soil Sciences at North Carolina State University. First, let's talk about the areas we'll be discussing. A borrow area, seen on the left here, is one from which we get the needed fill to build up the highway. This is typically in our coastal plain, where, for instance, the highway may need to be built up to a bridge over a railroad or another highway. In the coastal plain, this would also require pumping of groundwater, which we'll cover later. You can see the pump right in the foreground here. The borrow is sort of an inside joke, as the material is really never returned. Often you'll see ponds near the highway at an overpass. These are borrow pits that have filled with groundwater once the pumps were removed. A waste area, seen on the right here, is where excess soil is permanently stored, usually close to the highway and sometimes visible if you're looking for them. Staging areas are where materials or equipment are being stored off-site and which may disturb large areas. In all cases, these are areas that are not on the project right away, and so they need a separate erosion and sediment control plan. The reclamation plan is drawn up to outline what needs to happen once operations cease in these areas. They must be approved before the activities are started. Note that stockpiled materials stored off the project right away also need their own erosion and sediment control plan. The plan is submitted to the lead engineer for approval, and all questions about the plan can be addressed to the field operations engineer with the roadside environmental unit. The key elements of a reclamation plan include the following: the reclamation plan form, a vicinity map to locate the area, signatures of the property owner who needs to agree to the plan, an environmental evaluation to ensure no unintended consequences, a letter from the State Historic Preservation Office indicating that they have no issues with the operation, the erosion and sediment control plan with appropriate measures, seeding specifications for stabilizing the area, and then an indication where the 1 year post-final review will occur to ensure the site is stabilized. Be sure to keep the property owner up to date on site progress. As mentioned earlier, borrow areas in the coastal plain usually require continuous pumping of groundwater to keep the area dry for working. If this occurs in these 15 counties, reporting of pumping of more than 10,000 gallons per day is required, and a permit is needed if you're going to be pumping more than 100,000 gallons per day. Most of the people in these counties rely on groundwater for their household use, so it is important that pumping is kept to a minimum. The reclamation plan is approved by submitting the plan to the lead engineer, who reviews it and gets input from the department environmental officer and the roadside environmental unit field operations staff. Once the requirements are addressed, the lead engineer will approve the plan. Once operations cease in the area, it has to be accepted by the landowner, who is notified of any additional stabilization efforts that are needed, and that a final inspection will occur a year later. Here's a scenario to consider. A widening project is progressing along a roadway, and the equipment is parked at different staging areas each day. How many reclamation plans are needed? This is actually a trick question, because in this case, the equipment would not be disturbing the area as much, so no plans would be needed. As we've discussed, most borrow pits require constant pumping to bring down the groundwater level to allow for excavation. Next, we'll discuss how this water needs to be handled. The discharged water will presumably end up in a nearby stream, so the level two person will need to record the turbidity or muddiness of the stream above and below the discharge point. This has to be done every day that the pump is actually running and within 30 minutes of pump startup. If the turbidity in the stream exceeds the limits, which we'll cover next, NCDOT needs to be notified. Here are the rules for different types of waters in the state and what the turbidity level cannot exceed when discharging into them. We'll see what these look like in the next slide. Note that if the turbidity in the water is higher than these levels in the upstream location, the pump discharge just cannot increase it further. It is common after storm events for streams to have much higher turbidity as a result of runoff and high flows. Here we see examples of different levels of turbidity as measured in NTUs, or nephelometric turbidity units, the standard scale we use. Notice how clear 10 NTU is, and that 50 NTUs is sort of like weak iced tea. Once you get over about 100, it's very hard to tell the difference by eye, but your turbidity meter can tell the difference. So in this example, the upstream sample read 38 NTUs in this non-trout stream. Since this is below the 50 NTU level, your discharge could raise the turbidity, but only to 50. It is important to get the downstream measurement after the discharge is fully mixed with the stream. Now in this example, perhaps after a storm, the upstream measurement is now 210 NTUs. This means that your pump discharge cannot raise this further at your downstream measurement point. If you look at this picture, do you think this would be a violation? Well, I don't think you'd need a meter to see that the turbidity in the stream is being raised considerably, and this would be a violation. Let's see if everybody's on board with our turbidity measurement decisions. A non-trout stream has an upstream turbidity of 40 NTUs. What turbidity level cannot be exceeded at the downstream sample location? Well, since 40 level is below 50, that means we cannot exceed 50 downstream. There are two tiers of measures to deal with pumped water quality. Tier one involves the typical systems we've reviewed: stilling basins and sediment bags, plus possibly land application if possible. There are a number of ways to introduce flocculants such as polyacrylamide to further clear up the water. Now, if these don't work, we have to move down to tier two. These include well point pumping or withdrawing the groundwater through many wells on the perimeter of the borrow pit, which is very expensive but also quite effective. Also, the walls of the pit could be manipulated to separate the groundwater from the mining area. Finally, you could be pumping through a sand filter, which can be effective and may be effective enough to get the turbidity within acceptable ranges. Here's a detailed diagram of a stilling basin, which we covered in the BMP section. Remember that pump hose outlet should be on a rock pad to prevent scour. Similarly, here's a special stilling basin diagram or sediment bag with the details that we've covered. In the picture, you can see the contractor not only put the bag on a flat area with gravel, but put rebar around it just for extra roll protection. Here's an example of a small pumping operation in a wet area. In this case, they only needed to pump for an hour each morning to be able to get their work area dry. They actually pumped dissolved PAM into the intake hose of the pump, and as a result got very clean water, as you can see coming out of the bag here, from the PAM treatment. As with most of the things that we present, there is more information on the connect.ncdot.gov site, as shown here, where the procedures for reclamation plans are outlined. This is the end of the reclamation plans module.